Good morning, and welcome to worship here at University Lutheran Church in Clemson, South Carolina. My name is John Heiliger, and I'll be presiding for the liturgy today. I'm the parish pastor, and our Lutheran campus minister, Pastor Josh Kestner, will be preaching for us this morning. I did need to update you that this past Thursday, late afternoon, George Harris did die. So we'll have Martha, Nancy, family, and friends in our prayers this morning. George will be laid to rest with a graveside service back in West Virginia, although the family will be receiving visitation, I believe, this Tuesday. I'll get out an email announcement to the whole congregation once we have the final details, but it looked like it was going to be Tuesday afternoon at 4 o'clock at Duckett Robinson. But again, we will send out a confirmation email, but mainly to keep Martha and Nancy and family and friends in our prayers today. For next Sunday, being the first Sunday of the month, we will be offering drive-up Holy Communion in the upper parking lot, so that will occur at 10:30. And since it's also going to be in concert with celebrating and assisting our youth for their collection for Super Bowl Sunday, please bring any canned goods with you that you would like to deposit those with us, and we'll get those over to Clemson Community Care. Likewise, financial contributions could be either made online and designate those for Super Bowl Sunday, or they can be mailed into the church office. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the prelude. Our service continues with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen. We continue with our gathering hymn, Hail to the Lord's Anointed.
Come.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Compassionate God, you gather the whole universe into your radiant presence and continually reveal your Son as our Savior. Bring wholeness to all that is broken and speak truth to us in our confusion, that all creation will see and know your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading is from the book of Deuteronomy. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me. From among your own people you shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, "If I hear the voice of the Lord my God anymore, or ever again see this great fire, I will die." Then the Lord replied to me, "They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name, a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die." The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Pastor John. All right, I'm going to grab something for the children's message. So if you want to gather all the children, and I'll meet you up front in just a minute. I want to talk about vocation today. So I might teach you a new word, so I wanted to grab this so I could spell it out for you. Oh, hey, Pastor John. What do you, got a lunchbox and a towel and a, what are you doing?
I'm going on vocation.
I'm glad I got this. Vacation, what? I'm talking about vocation. I don't mean we're not going to the beach. Vocation.
Oh, bummer.
Get out of here with that. Oh my goodness. Vocation, that's what I'm talking about today. Pastor John just read a passage that talks about doing something that God wants us to do. And that's what we call vocation sometimes in the church, with an O, not with an A. And so vocation is trying to figure out what to do, what God wants us to do with our lives. And so we read all these stories in the Bible that God created the world, or God created people to live in the world around us. And we use vocation as a word to figure out how God wants us to live in the world. God created people with all different kinds of things that they're good at, or different gifts that we might say. Some people are really good at sports. Some people are really good at math. Some people are good at science. Some people are good at making pizza. Some people are good at making soup. Some people are good at making cake. I'm sorry, I'm just a little bit hungry. Some people are really good at making food. I'm already thinking about lunch, and it's not even 9:30 yet. But all different kinds of things that people are good at. So vocation is when we think about what we are good at and how we can use those things in the world around us to take care of the world that God created, or to take care of the people in the world around us, to make the world a better place. What are you good at? What does God want you to be doing with your life? That's vocation. Now, a lot of times in these children's sermons, I ask the question, what do you want to be when you grow up? And that's a good question to ask when we're talking about vocation. What do you want to be when you grow up? What are you good at? How can you do those things? But vocation is also about the way that we live our everyday lives. So vocation can be when you wake up in the morning, and maybe you like mornings, and that's pretty easy for you. You just hop out of bed and get some breakfast. Maybe if you're like me and you don't like mornings, that takes a little bit longer. But whenever you are waking up, when you wake up, you ask yourself, what does God want me to do today? Where does God want me to go? How can I do what I'm good at to take care of the world around me, to take care of the people around me, to make the world around me a better place? And that is vocation. It's a little different from vacation, but it's still a very good thing. So let's pray, and then we'll go on with worship, and then throughout the rest of the day, we'll see what God wants us to be doing with our lives, what God wants for our vocation. Let us pray. God, thanks for making us. Thanks for giving us gifts, making us good at doing certain things. Thank you for all the different things that people do in our lives to make us happy, to make our lives better. Help us to understand our personal vocation. Help us to understand what you want us to do with our lives, to take care of people, to take care of places, and just to make this world a better place. Thank you for those vocations. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks, guys. I'm going to grab my Bible and read the next story. Not sure what beach Pastor John thought he was going to on a rainy day like this anyway. Vocation. The gospel today is from the gospel of Mark. I always say that that's my favorite because it's the shortest gospel, so it gets right to the point. But this is from the gospel of Mark, and it's Jesus' first miracle of sorts in the gospel of Mark. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in the synagogue a man who had an unclean spirit. And he cried out, "What do you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked the man, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing the man, crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. One of the glimmers of hope that we're holding on to in 2021 is the implementation of a vaccine, something that might give communities that have been exhausted by this pandemic a chance to catch their breath. Pastor John is compiling a joyful list of at least 36 people here in this congregation who have already received one of their vaccine shots, and at least 3 people who have received both shots. And this list offers just that: hope and joy, things that are hard to come by these days. One day, stories will be told of the heroic scientists who helped to create these vaccines. Under pressure and against precedent, they put together something of a miracle. One thing that I've been reading and learning about the biochemistry of creating vaccines and other medicines, is that horseshoe crab blood is invaluable in this process. Horseshoe crabs are these odd and ancient creatures that you can find in the hands-on areas of many aquariums. They have hard shells on top, they have spider-like legs and a sharp tail underneath, and they are safe to touch. That's why they're in this kind of petting zoo area of most aquariums, but I've always been afraid to do it myself. Apparently, these bottom feeders of the ocean are not only good for show and tell, but their blood actually helps to identify toxic bacteria that may be present in certain substances. So scientists then extract the blood from these crabs and they mix it in with a vaccine to ensure that the vaccine is safe to inject. If there are any toxins present in this vaccine, then the mixture starts to gel together a little bit. But if it's safe to use, then nothing happens. So behind the scenes, horseshoe crabs are saving lives. They're saving lives by pointing out dangerous things that might offer a threat to life in things like vaccines. Now, these stories about Jesus casting out unclean spirits or healing people who are demon-possessed can be difficult to comprehend in our contemporary culture. There's a sort of supernatural and spiritual battle going on that we might not fully understand, a struggle between good and evil. But I think that we can approach these stories in a similar way to these facts about horseshoe crab blood. In the same way that the crab's blood helps to point out and prevent any of the harms of bacteria, Jesus' interaction with these unclean spirits is a way of identifying evil and averting certain dangers in his community. In the Gospel of Mark, like I said, this story is one of Jesus' first acts of public ministry, his first miracle, really. And as a first, it must be fairly important, something that we should pay attention to. Jesus shows up in Galilee with this unexpected authority, different from the religious scribes. He has the ability and the responsibility, really, to cast out unclean spirits, to call out evil when he sees it, and to get rid of it. Not in a Batman superhero kind of way, but by recognizing the things, perhaps invisible things, that are causing distress in their society. What's evil here is the unclean spirit, the thing that has made this man untouchable, or the thing that puts him on the outside of the social sphere. The evils that Jesus has the authority to deal with in stories like this are the things that cause division, the things that make life difficult or impossible for certain people, the things that might directly or indirectly cause death. Evil is what is actually getting in the way of the kingdom of God, getting in the way of the kind of world that God created them to live in, created us to live in. And so instead of ignoring these things and allowing them to persist as they have for many years, Jesus' action in the world confronts them head on. Maybe that's a little easier for us to understand. It seems like those are things that we might talk about more often than unclean spirits in our faith community. These might even be activities that we can relate to. These are things that we find ourselves doing in the world around us or trying to do in our everyday lives. Because these evils, these kinds of evils, are exactly the kinds of things that we are trying to dismantle when we are in the business of loving our neighbors. And so maybe we can understand that this authority, this responsibility can be overwhelming, that it's difficult, that it consumes our time and our energy, that it's often countercultural. And so it's something that we have to learn. It's something that we have to teach ourselves often. You know, some of the most well-equipped teachers for these kinds of things are authors of children's books. They have a gentle use of language that helps to frame good and evil. They have a way of portraying the world in which these children live and talking about the ways that they either should or should not interact with it. Here's an example. This past week, the world recognized International Holocaust Remembrance Day. It's a sobering reminder of the kinds of evils that exist in our world. A part of history as violent and traumatic as the Holocaust can be difficult to introduce to younger children. But recently, a new book for children ages 6 to 9 was recently published, and it's called Nikki and Vera, A Quiet Hero of the Holocaust and the Children That He Rescued. This children's author focuses on Nikki, Nicholas Winton, who saved 669 children from the Nazis in the late 1930s. It's this heartwarming story about the power of extreme feats of love. But the author also spent time describing the many emotions that came with all of the loss that these children experienced. Vera was one of the hundreds of children that were saved, but she had to say goodbye to her parents who died. She had to say goodbye to the cats that she loved. She had to say goodbye to the comforts and the joys of the life that she was living. Young readers of this book then learned that it was a tragedy that all of these horrific things happened just because these people were Jewish, that they were terrorized just because of who they were. While learning about the miracle of Nikki and Vera, children are also able to comprehend that the Holocaust was evil, that it should never happen again, that all people should be treated with extreme love, no matter what faith they have, no matter what they look like, no matter how different their lives might seem. And in these simple words of a children's book like this, we too can learn that it's our responsibility to identify toxins or to cast out demons and unclean spirits, to confront evil head on in our communities. It's a constant area of growth, and we grow and we learn bit by bit each day. One of the things that I've been learning about recently, and I think that it helps with this kind of work, is the difference between equality and equity. You might have heard people talking about this too. Equality is a sort of baseline way of interacting with others. We treat everybody equally. In our personal lives, that might mean that we don't discriminate in the ways that we love our neighbors. We don't give more attention to some groups over others. In the community, it might mean that we advocate for distributing resources equally amongst groups of people. We vote on policies of education or economics or environmentalism that will be equally applied across all different neighborhoods. Equity, though, is taking it a step further, it seems. It doesn't divide equally, but it divides based on need. That means giving more to areas that might need more and less to areas that might need less. Equity is more than a simple equation, but it's this mindset that makes you take a long, hard look at the world around you. It identifies groups of people who aren't as fortunate or as valued in society for many different reasons, and it tries to mend the gap between those groups. It also begs the question of why those kinds of divisions exist in our world in the first place. Equity work, I think, resembles the kind of work that Jesus was doing. He didn't divide his time up equally amongst all the people in that community. He spent a lot of time with the people who were lonely because they were outcasts, the poor, the sinners, the people who just didn't fit in. He spent more time with them because they needed to know that God loved them, that he loved them, even if it felt like the whole world around them did not. When Jesus confronts evil head on, he dismantles these structures in society that have created barriers between people. He identifies toxic systems that are causing pain and suffering for certain groups of people. And he casts out the demons that get in the way of real, loving human relationships. The authority and the responsibility that we see in the gospel story this morning is one of equity. As we find ourselves still in the middle of this pandemic, but on the side of hope that there are better days ahead, we can understand how precious life is. We count the blessings that we have each day. We count the opportunities that we have to get out of bed each day, the reasons that we have to get out of bed each day. And that re-energized purpose for life should awaken in us a passion for something like equity, a passion for getting rid of the evils that persist, a passion for caring about God's creation in countercultural and amazing ways. And so this morning we pray for hope. We pray for a future and for optimism created by these vaccines. And we pray for the courage to do the work of casting out the unclean spirits that are still glaringly present today and tomorrow. Amen.
Our service continues now with our confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all those who are in need. For all who share the gospel and proclaim freedom in Christ throughout the world, prophets, teachers, pastors, deacons, and lay leaders, for the church and its ministries, we pray, have mercy, O God. For all God's works in creation, plants and animals, water and soil, forests and farms, and for those tasked with protecting our natural resources and all that exists, we pray, have mercy, O God. For government and leaders, cities and nations, rescue professionals and legal aid attorneys, elected officials and grassroots organizers, for all responsible for the well-being of civil society, we pray, have mercy, O God. For those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, those who are sick and hospitalized, those living with HIV, AIDS, those struggling with mental illness, those who are hungry or homeless, and all in any need, including Larry, Freddie, Jimmy, Rosalind, Ellen, Gail, Pat, Tony, Joyce, Cheryl, Richard, John, Julie, Bill, Sue, Greg, and those we now name either silently or aloud. For caregivers, hospice workers, and home health aides, we pray, have mercy, O God. For the concerns of this congregation, those who travel, those absent from worship, those celebrating birthdays or anniversaries, for the people of God in this place and for other needs in our community, we pray, have mercy, O God. Here, other intercessions may be offered either silently or aloud. We pray, have mercy, O God. Healing God, we give thanks for the dozens within our congregation and the millions across our country who have begun receiving the vaccine for COVID-19. Continue to keep us safe till the virus subsides or we ourselves receive the vaccine. Be with our healthcare workers and others who come in close contact through their work, including Kathy, Donnie, Jen, Sherry, Leslie, Molly, Cindy, Jennifer, Tiffany, KD, Patrick, Beth, Hannah, Lee, Lawson, John, Mike, Smith, Joseph, Julie, Bill, Stephanie, we pray, have mercy, O God. God, we give you thanks for the covenant you made with us in the waters of baptism. We give thanks for all the baptized who have died in the Lord, including George Harris. We ask for you to comfort Martha, their daughter Nancy, and the family and friends grieving his death, and reassure all of us that nothing can ever separate us from your love, including death. We pray, have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share that peace with one another. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is our duty and delight that we should everywhere and always offer thanks and praise to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, who is your light made manifest to all the nations. And so, with the church on earth, all creation, and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O holy God, you are the life and light of all. By your powerful word, you created all things. Through the prophets, you called your people to be a light to the nations. Blessed are you for Jesus, your Son. He is your light, shining in our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and might. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his preaching and healing, his dying and rising, and his promise to come again, We await that day when all the universe will rejoice in your holy and life-giving light. By your Spirit, bless us and this meal, that refreshed with this heavenly food, we may be light for the world, revealing the brilliance of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we share the elements with one another or receive them ourselves or offered with the body of Christ given or broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. This is the Lord's table, and all are welcome. Let us pray. Christ Jesus, at this table we have feasted on your very life and are strengthened for our journey. Send us forth from this banquet nourished in body and in spirit to proclaim your good news and to serve others in your name. Amen. God the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen. Go in peace. Be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.
See you.